Good morning. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us for a 30th anniversary celebration here and for service this morning. Yeah, praise God. Praise God. Yep, you're already standing. Let's all stand and praise God for all the things and all the provisions and blessing He's provided over the last 30 years. And we praise Him for the things He's going to do in the future as well. So let's stand and let's sing together.
The God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, He parted the raging seas. My God, He holds the victory.
Yeah.
There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Oh, oh, oh. We shout out your praise.
We sing.
We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. Cause He hung upon that cross, and He rose up from that grave. My God still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
So we were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise.
We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Oh, we shout out your praise. There is joy in this house. There is joy in this house today. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise.
Good to praise the Lord together, amen. As a church, over the years, we've sung hundreds of different songs together. The styles have evolved, the words have changed, but the heart of the message remains the same, and that is exalting the mighty name of Jesus together. So come on, let's continue to sing.
Jesus, you're the center. Everything revolves, and everything revolves around you, Jesus, you.
Come on.
still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet, and I never will forget that you
just our church, Lord, but I look out and I see your church, your body, Lord, your children, and how faithful you've been to us all of our lives, the stories, the testimonies that you've given us of your goodness and your faithfulness, Lord. We praise you as our faithful Father, our faithful friend, Lord, who is like you. So God, today we've gathered to celebrate you for all that you've done for us. You are so worthy of all of the honor, all of the glory, and all of the praise that we could bring to you today. So would you be pleased, Lord, with our song? We love you, Jesus. We pray all this in your powerful name. We all say together, amen. Come on, let's give him praise one more time. He's so good. Yeah. So please be seated and we'll continue on with a special video.
This is Sherry with Loving One by One here in Uganda, and I'm at New Creation Center, where many of you sponsor our children, and we so greatly appreciate all of that. I want to give a shout out to South Bay Community Church. Happy 30th anniversary, and may God bless you with triple that amount in the future. But we want to thank you for all that you have done, South Bay Community Church, for this ministry. You have been a huge blessing to us, and we could not have done all of this without your love, your prayers, and your support. Thank you so much.
Hi, SBCC fam. We are the Nance family serving in Sapporo, Japan. We're so excited to be ministry partners with you guys, and we're even more excited to wish you guys a happy 30th anniversary. May God bless you guys in the coming year and many years in the future. So from Sapporo, Japan, Otanjoubi omedetto gozaimasu.
South Bay Community Church 30 shounen kinen
omedetto.
Watashi tachi no tame ni itsumo
arigatou.
Dear Pastor Gary and brothers and sisters of South Bay Community Church, we would like to congratulate you with 30th anniversary. 30 years of dedication, 30 years of hard work, 30 years of faithfulness to the Lord.
Thank you very much for your prayers, love, and faithful support.
May our Lord Jesus Christ continue to bless you, your church, your families, and your ministry for His glory. We love you.
Hey, South Bay Community Church, Lawrence here from Brisbane, Australia. I hope you guys have all been doing really, really well. I just want to say a quick thank you for your prayers and your support in getting the gospel out to the nation of Japan. Together this year, we have been able to put the gospel message in front of 500,000 people in Japan online. Now that's huge, and this wouldn't have been possible without your prayers and your support. So thank you so very much. My continued prayer for you personally and for your church is that God will continue to use you to share the gospel with those around you and to the nations. So thank you so much again. God bless and happy 30th anniversary. Bye for now.
Hello, this is Sarah, and I want to wish you a very happy 30th anniversary. Thank you.
Hi, we are Sandy family.
Happy 30th anniversary, church.
In behalf of Christian Gospel Church, Amuan, Katigan, the whole Philippines.
Happy 30th anniversary, South Bay Community Church. Thank you for your support. In Christ, you are blessed and highly favored. We love you.
Woo! Man, that is so awesome. Hey, good morning, everybody. Welcome to South Bay Community Church. My name is James. This is Dave. We're some of the pastors here. And we just want to say happy anniversary. Would you turn to somebody and tell them happy anniversary? Woo! Happy anniversary, everybody. Man, we are just so grateful that you guys would join us. Man, we're celebrating 30 years of God's goodness and faithfulness. But speaking of 30 years, Dave, that shirt looks like it's 30 years old.
You are right. This is a vintage 1992 first ever South Bay Community Church shirt worn by Pastor Gary as he preached. Smells like 30-year-old Pastor Gary.
Wow. 30-year-old Pastor Gary. Wow, I can't even picture that. But anyway, guys, you know what? As awesome and as amazing as that shirt is, Dave, no one else can have that shirt. No one can buy that shirt, but they can buy one of these shirts that are celebrating our 30th anniversary. They're out in the back in the parking lot where we're going to have a party, and we've got all sorts of different colors, sizes, even sizes for kids as well. And we also have water bottles that we want to use to celebrate our 30th anniversary. And, you know, these shirts are about $15. The water bottles are $20, but we got a special. If you buy both of them, it's $30 for the 30th anniversary. Nice. And so we hope that you guys will come out and celebrate with us in the back, pick up a shirt or a water bottle, and man, come and join us for this awesome celebration. But speaking of celebration, Dave, what are we doing back there?
Well, it wouldn't be South Bay Community Church celebration without food, guys. So we have the Habit hamburger truck getting ready to serve some burgers and fries up to each and every one of you. As soon as we exit out there in the back parking lot, there'll be desserts, refreshments as well. We'll have more directions on this at the end of service, but just to get you guys in the right direction, as you guys exit the worship center, maybe you're in the Faith Center in the lobby, as soon as you guys head out to that back hallway behind the worship center, head to your left, you'll see the line there, and they'll take care of you from there. So that's the celebration for this week, and we have a celebration coming up in October, too,
yes,
right?
Yes, we do. We got on Sunday, the 16th, we hope that you all will join us for our baptism celebration, where people from our church, our brothers and sisters, are going to declare their faith and their devotion to Jesus Christ, and you'll get to hear how Jesus literally changed their lives. Maybe some of you guys are thinking about baptism or wondering, am I supposed to get baptized? What's that all about? Well, we invite you all to join us for our class next Sunday, the 2nd. It's going to be at 1 p.m. right here in the worship center. Attending the class doesn't mean you'll get baptized, but it's a great opportunity to learn and see if this is something for you. But we hope that you guys will mark your calendars for the 16th to join us for that amazing celebration. But one other thing that we want to share about what's coming up in this month for all the women out there, we want to give you guys an opportunity to come together and to learn together by our women's ministry putting on this simulcast by Beth Moore. It's a great opportunity to learn more about God's word, also get connected with other women here at the church. It's going to be happening on Friday night, the 14th, and then Saturday, the 15th. Friday night will be in the evening. Saturday will be from the morning till about noon, and it's free, so there's no excuse. Come on out, be a part of this awesome opportunity of learning and being together with other women here at our church. But there is one optional lunch that they're going to have available on Saturday after they finish the simulcast. But for this lunch, there is a cost. It's $10 if you like a lunchbox. And I think in the lunchbox, it includes like salmon and pork or salmon and chicken. But they do need to order those ahead of time. And so for those orders, those orders need to come in on Sunday the 9th. And so again, go to our church's website for more information about this or to sign up. But also go to our church's website or use our app for all the different ministries that we have here at our church. We have so many different things for our youth, for kids, for young adults, for couples, for families, for young adults. And man, we want to encourage you guys to take a look at our church's website, because we've gone from a small little community church that just reached out to our community here, and now we're extending it out into the world.
Thanks, Pastor James. And church, we want to thank you. Thank you for your faithfulness and giving. As you guys can see from that video, God has really been good to us. And through your serving, through your giving, we've been able to spread the gospel here in the community and overseas as well. If you're wondering what are some ways you can give, we'll put them right up here on the screen for you. You can go to southbaycommunitychurch.com/give. You can use our app through PushPay. You can mail it here to the church address. Or if you physically have it here this morning, you can put it in the box in the back of the worship center or the lobby. Well, we've been on quite a journey over these past 30 years. We'd love to show you a little bit of that in this next video, as God has been so faithful to us in the past, the present, and the future. Let's take a look.
We started at Hope Chapel Gateway, small group, and then we progressed to the Japanese Cultural Institute and started South Bay Community Church. We set up at the JCI from a truck. We had plywood stages. We set up all the chairs. My wife made the curtains for the stage. And at one point, we got so desperate that they had me lead vocals.
So I would drive the trucks in the morning to church before service. And I think we'd have to get there 2 hours before the service started. The truck, sometimes the battery would get stolen because it was just parked out on a little lot next to the church office. And then we moved to this other location. It was down 190th Street between Western and Normandy at that time. And I think when we made the move there, we had a capital funds campaign, and there was maybe between 150 to 200 people in the congregation at that time.
Every Christmas, we'd do a Christmas journey, and everyone got involved. And it was just a fun time because it was interactive. You travel to different rooms. And another time I can remember, this one really blew my mind because I was super impressed at the production that they did of, it was like High School Musical, but it was Christmas musical. That had to be just one of the best productions because when you brought your family to see or any friends, they can connect. They could connect to that.
You know, when we first moved into this new location, but we were a little short on funding, so we actually had to do some financing in order to get into this building. We paid off all the loans as of 2018, and I thought that was like a God thing, because it was totally awesome that we extended ourselves, we stepped out in faith because we weren't sure, you know, with the financing if we were gonna make it, but God provided for us.
South Bay Community Church is my home. I've been here for 26 years, and as years went by, some of us Hawaii people got together, and about 15 years ago, we created our ukulele ministry.
And I walk in, and it was kind of intimidating because there's like 30, 40 people. You know, they said, please introduce yourself. I introduced myself, and you know, they all, you know, they're speaking pidgin. And I said, you guys talk funny, he says, and you know, I think Alan Hamada and a couple of guys said, no, you talk funny. And then Alan, you know, he kept saying, hey, Terry, you know, come to church, come to church. As soon as I heard Pastor Gary and Pastor Greg talk, I felt like they were talking to me.
I like the atmosphere. I like, I don't have to dress up with a tie and a suit, and I found a home.
It's my home. I love my pastors. Even you, Pastor Gary, yeah, they're family to me.
I think we're all called to share God's love with everyone, no matter their culture, no matter who they are or what they do. And that's not easy. But we have a ministry here, our pastors here, that are so supportive of every aspect of every person that it makes you want to do that. It makes you want to go out and do what you're supposed to do what God has called us to do.
This church is unique because there's a lot of generations that are coming together in community. There's a lot of intention behind having ministry for each age group.
For me especially, the basketball ministry was a great opportunity to kind of engage with a lot of different age groups.
And they're starting a Bible study, right?
Yeah.
Out of your group?
Yeah,
your
out of our team, yeah, which has been a really awesome outcome from that.
So in 2020, when we were watching services online, I saw my first video recap of Vacation Bible School, and my socks were knocked off. Like, I was so excited. I was like, this is so neat. what the church does for the kids. And we do hope to have children one day, and it would be wonderful to just know that SBCC is already doing so much for the youth.
So I started coming to the high school ministry during my second year of high school. The worship music really stood out to me, and they really did a really good job of preaching the gospel through music. And my favorite memory was definitely our first retreat, where I really felt like God was calling me to South Bay to be called my home.
I always enjoy worship, for sure, and Legacy. Always the worship team gets us ready for the message, and the games are always just keeping us interactive with all the other students. Growing up from freshman year all the way to senior year right now, Legacy has really influenced me with great leadership, and advisory has given me a whole new perspective on God.
I really like the junior high ministry here because you get to go deeper in the Word with people around your age, and they just help you understand the Bible more.
My favorite memory at SBCC is probably my first retreat at Evo, and I got to meet like a lot of new friends. The teachers in Kids Crew are really nice, and they always teach us new things about what God wants us to do and what they have to teach us.
Yeah, the advisors just really helped me through just like getting to know God more, getting to know people in the Bible more.
The messages are like really inspiring because they said that the church is not just a building, it's built up more of the people. Even if we didn't have this building, the people are the church.
I like Kids Room because I get to see all my friends. The group leaders, they help us learn about Jesus and the Bible. Sometimes we do games and sometimes we do crafts. I really like the Bible station at VBS.
I love the teachers in preschool. A boy, the teachers are really smart.
The church is about the people.
The hopes and prayers are that the church is able to continue to grow and has the resources to reach new people, and as it grows, to continue to have a close community, tight community feel.
I believe our church is already touching people here in the community and far and wide in other countries, and I just pray that we continue to do that.
My hope for the church is really to just grow in love for one another, and especially for Jesus. I want us to be people who are very bold in our faith, who would go out really to the ends of the earth and just proclaim his good news and be very faithful and be very bold in doing so.
Smyrna was one of the two churches that Christ had nothing against in the seven churches in Revelation. I want South Bay Community Church to be one of those churches, like Smyrna, a church that God holds nothing against, that the leadership and the staff and the people, the congregation, I can see that they're so dedicated, they're so gifted, but I just want to see that they continue to lean on God heavily and to seek His will. I look forward to seeing what God's going to do in the next 30 years or until He comes back for us again.
Isn't that great? Wow. Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us today for our 30th anniversary celebration, and all of you online as well. Thank you for being out there and checking in what we're doing here. You know, it's hard to believe that it's been 10,950 days since we opened our doors for the very first time on September the 20th, 1992. And those first 6 years as a church were quite brutal, as you saw in the video. We did church out of a truck, and I often wondered whether we would survive and be around for another week. But by God's grace, here we are 3 decades later, and I am so thankful. In fact, if I could choose just one word to describe how it is that I've been feeling today, it would be the word thankful. I am so very thankful. Thankful to God for His goodness and grace, because without Him, none of this would have been possible at all. I'm also thankful just that he saved me, just that he allowed me to become a Christian. I was the first in my family to come to know Christ, and I wouldn't be surprised if I was the first Shiohama ever to come to know Christ, because we come from a family of Buddhists, including a Buddhist priest that I know of in our family, going back for hundreds and hundreds of years back in Japan. So I am so thankful that Jesus allowed me to become a Christian. I'm also thankful for all the special people that God has placed in my life over these years. Of course, my parents, my mom and dad, my brother Larry and his wife Dee, and the one that I'm the most thankful for is my wife Cheryl, who I met on that very first day that we started, September 20th, 1992, and she's been with me ever since. You know, she has been my best friend, my ministry partner, and the biggest supporter that I've ever had. And I've come to appreciate the fact that she will always tell me the truth about whatever it is I need to hear. Sometimes I don't want to hear it, but she will always tell me the truth. For example, she will tell me when I don't have a very good message, and she'll just say, "That was a lousy message." She has also said to me, "You know, your swaying is making me seasick. You need to stop swaying. You know, I get up here, and now you know that I sway." And so somebody told me during the mealtime right after the first service that the next time you start swaying, we're going to all start swaying. And the audience, I thought that was hilarious. But she will always tell me the truth. She will even ask questions that are very truthful. Like, she'll ask the question, "You're not going to wear that shirt, are you?" And for those guys, you know, that's code for, "That's an ugly shirt. Don't you dare wear it." But you've heard the saying that behind every good man is a great woman. And that's my wife, Cheryl. She is a great, great lady. And I am so thankful for her. No one has worked harder these last 30 years than her. And no one has done more to set and establish the culture of warmth and kindness that is South Bay Community Church than her. I really believe she's done that. I'm also so very thankful for my daughters, Kylie and Natalie. I know that Natalie's here today. Kylie was here last night. And I'm thankful for them because of all the sacrifices that they have made as preachers' kids. PKs is what they call them. And for all their lives, they have lived in a glass bubble for everyone to see as I tell stories about them. But, you know, they say that PKs don't do very well, and that seems to be the case for a lot of different reasons. But Kylie and Natalie have really thrived, and I believe that the reason they have is really because of you, because of the way that you have loved them, the way that you've treated them, not any differently than anybody else because they're PKs, but just because they're just special, just like everybody else is special. And that really leads me to the fourth thing that I'm thankful for, and that's you. I am so thankful for each and every one of you, for all of you who have served over the years, and so many of you have served this weekend. And over the years, I was just thinking about what are all the things that people have done. I mean, coming and setting up chairs and taking down chairs and setting up things and setting up for events and taking things down and serving on the worship team and serving on the tech team, pushing buttons so that we're getting this message out to hundreds of people all across the country and across the world. For those of you who served in Kids Crew, for those of you who have gone on mission trips, for those of you who've supported mission trips, for those of you who just give generously of your time and of your gifts and of your financial resources, those of you who pray for others. And I could go on and on and on all the ways that you've served. And I, you know, this church wouldn't be what it is without you. And I've just got to tell you that it has been the greatest honor of my life to have been your pastor for the last 30 years. And for some of you, I've only been your pastor for a few years, and I'm just only one of your pastors because there's six of us now. And for some of you, I've been your pastor for only a few months, and then some for only a few weeks, because some of you are new to our church. And I want to tell you, if you're new to our church, you also mean the world to me. And if I could describe it this way. I think the best way to do it would be just to say that you are family. You are my family. You are the people I love doing life with. And over the years, we have laughed a lot because, you know, we love to laugh. And then we've cried a lot because we've sometimes cried tears of joy and then sometimes tears of sadness. We've done that. We've been through some tough times together. I remember the times we've been through some real ups and downs, those tough times when we were homeless for 3.5 years, meeting in a hotel and sometimes meeting in a park because we didn't have anywhere to meet. The pandemic was certainly a tough time, and it's so good to be coming out of that. And throughout it all, you have always been there, unwavering in your support and your prayers for me and our church, and I cannot be more thankful. And even when I made mistakes, and boy, in 30 years, I have made so many of them, I could write a book, but so many of them, and even when I've made mistakes, you have always been so gracious, and you've always been so forgiving as we have been able to move on. So, beloved, thank you so much for being my family. I mean that with all my heart, and even for all of you who are online, and I probably haven't met many of you because you're all over the country and all over the world, and I know that many of you, maybe most of you, consider South Bay Community Church to be your family. Well, you are our family, and I can't wait for the day when we're all together, reunited in heaven, all of you who are online, and I hope that when we get to heaven, you know, we said last week that there probably aren't floors, but there are rooms, and I hope that there will be a room, and on the gate or the door of the room, there'll be a sign that says South Bay Community Church, and online and you know, present, and we'll all gather together for all eternity to do life together with the Lord. So I'm looking forward to that. You know, a lot has changed in 30 years. Things are different today in 2022 than they were in 1992. And we've talked a little bit about this in previous messages, but one of the things that's changed is that the world has gotten darker. It's darker today than it has ever been in my lifetime. Another thing that's changed is that people's hearts have grown colder because their love for God has waned. But there's one thing that hasn't changed in the last 30 years, and that's the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's the one thing that hasn't changed, and that has been the driving impetus for our church from the very beginning. In fact, the slogan that we came up with is that our mission statement, actually, is that we are about helping people all over the world who are far from God find and follow Jesus Christ. That's what's driven us. That's our mission, to help people find and follow Jesus Christ. And the reason why the gospel is so important is because I believe that Jesus is the only hope of the world. As we look about the world today and we see all the darkness and we see all the crime and we see all the hate and we see all the anger and we see things literally disintegrating before our very eyes, the only hope that this world has is Jesus. And therefore, we need to preach the gospel, and that's what we've endeavored to do. Not only is Jesus the only hope, but we need to preach the gospel because, as we say around here often, it's not okay for one person to go to hell. Not okay for one single person to go to hell. And so that's why we've endeavored to help people find and follow Christ. And, you know, when I started South Bay Community Church, it was never my dream that we would become a mega church. I'm surprised that it's grown the way that it has, and I'm surprised that there's as many people as there are here. But it was never my dream that we would become a mega church. I want to be a big church. I want to be a big church. And never, not even close to that. My only dream was that people would experience what I've experienced. The only dream that I had was that people would know Jesus as I've gotten to know Jesus, that they would know that their sins are forgiven, that they would know that if they put their faith in him, they could live forever in heaven with him one day. And that if they put their faith in Christ, that they'll also get a family. And they could be loved by other people, and they could do life together. And that's what it's always been about, that I wanted people to know Jesus. And the reason, because God is real. God is real. And if you don't believe in him, I'm telling you today, after nearly 50 years as a Christ follower, he is real. And Jesus came to earth to die on a cross for your sins, and he was raised from the dead. Those are all truths you can take to the bank. And you see, you can't keep something as good as Jesus to yourself. He must be shared. And that's what we've tried to do. And I think the good news is, I think that a lot of people have come to know Christ in the last 30 years through our ministry. I can't put a number on it, but I think a lot of people have. But the bad news is, there are probably more people. In fact, I know that there are more people who haven't come to Christ than who have. And that's through our ministry. And that's not okay either. And so that just means that our work's cut out for us. It means that we have a lot of work to do. And so today we're going to celebrate, and then tomorrow we go back to work, because there are people that we need to tell Jesus about. So I believe that even though the world is getting darker and people's hearts are growing colder, I believe that the best days of ministry are ahead for us. Because the darker the world gets, the brighter the light of Jesus shines, the brighter the light is. And so I want to close with this story, and then I want to introduce our guest. In his autobiography, Benjamin Franklin wrote about life in Philadelphia in the 1770s. And he talked about how life in Philadelphia in the 1770s, I mean, they didn't have any lights. There was no electricity. They didn't have flashlights. They didn't have a cell phone or a smartphone that you can turn on your flashlight and you'd have lights all of a sudden. And so when there wasn't a moon over the sky on a moonless night, Philadelphia, the city, would be pitch black. In fact, the same thing would be true here. If we didn't have any lights, zero lights, when night came here in the South Bay, it would be very dark. And Ben Franklin writes about that, how in Philadelphia it was pitch black at night on a moonless night, and people would trip and it would be common for them to fall and they would get lost. And then there were homeless people even back then. And he says there was crime on the streets. And so it was a very dangerous place to be around in Philadelphia in the 1770s. And so he said, I came up with an idea. He said, I came up with an idea, and that is if we can get everyone to get a little lamp, basically, and put it on a stick and put it out in front of their house and light it up with a candle, he said, we could start lighting up our city. And when he shared that idea with some people, they said, oh, no, we're not going to do that. It's as if men love darkness more than they love light. And so he says, well, you're not going to do it, but I'm going to do it. So he designed this lamp. It looks just like this. It has four glass sides to it and a little chimney on top. And what you would do is you just get a candle and stick it inside, and the smoke would rise out of the chimney. And then you would get that little lamp, and he said he would stick it on a post, basically, or a stick. And he would stick it on there, and it would give off light. And nobody wanted to do it, but he says, okay, well, I'm going to do it. And so he got one of these little lamps and put a candle inside, stuck it up in front of his house, and it gave off a beautiful, warm glow, a little light. And some of his neighbors would walk by and go, wow, that's kind of nice. You can actually see right around that area. And I thought it was really cool that the next night his neighbor said, I'm going to do the same thing. So he got one of these lamps and put a candle and stuck it up in front of his house. And now there were two lights. And people thought, well, this is kind of cool. Somebody else across the street says, I'm going to do the same thing. So he got the lamp, put it in front of his house, and before you know it, everybody on the street put a lamp in front of their house, put a candle lit, stuck it on a pole, and that whole street was lit up. Well, of course, people heard about it all over the city, and they would come to the street, and they'd just go, look at this street. Look at how bright it is. And so they all went back and they all started putting lamps in front of their house. And before you know it, the entire city of Philadelphia was lit up at night, all because one man decided to be the light. You know, when I heard that story, I thought to myself, you know, we don't have the problem, unless they're rolling blackouts, we don't have the problem of it being pitch black at night. But our world, as I said, is getting spiritually darker by the day, right? And I believe, when I heard this story, I thought to myself, that's why God put South Bay Community Church here for such a time as this, that we would be a light to the rest of the world. Not a physical light like a lamp, but a spiritual light. And that would be along the lines of what Jesus said. He said, go let your light shine before men in such a way that they would see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. And so, church, I just want to say to you as we close, this is why God put us here. And this is what we need to continue to do. And so as we enter our 31st year as a church, we start the work again tomorrow. Continue to shine the light of Jesus. Wherever God's planted you, wherever he puts you, you may be in another city and another country. Be the light of Jesus so that everybody around you will know who he is. Now, I want to introduce our special guest. And I asked him to come down because more than anyone else, other than Jesus himself, Pastor Matt Hannon is most responsible for us being here today. And here's what I mean by that. He was my pastor at the time I had this dream of starting a church in the South Bay. And he latched onto that, and he believed in my dream that there could be a thriving, vibrant church in the South Bay. And he and others have told me that the South Bay is often referred to as the graveyard of churches. I don't know if you know that, but it's referred to as the graveyard of churches because churches, for the most part, don't do well in the South Bay. And so he was behind that idea, and then I began to have doubts. Oh, I don't think I can do this. Well, I haven't finished seminary, and oh, I'm single, and I had all kinds of excuses. And he was the one who kept exhorting me and encouraging me. He was the one that kept saying, "You can do this, Gary. You can do this." And I know he said that not because I'm some brilliant, talented guy. He said that because he knew what God can do through me and through anybody. Because as I've said often, so very often, I'm just as ordinary can be. But with God inside of you, anybody can do anything. And he not only believed in the dream, but even when I didn't believe in myself, he believed in me. You know, some time ago, I think it was Pastor Corey Sheeta who said at our church in a message, he said that he referred to me as your spiritual father. I think that's what he said. He says, "Gary Shiohama is your spiritual father." Well, if I'm your spiritual father, then Matt Hannon would be your spiritual grandfather. And so I've asked him to come out and share some spiritual grandfatherly thoughts with us on this occasion. So I want to ask you, will you join me in giving Pastor Matt Hannon a warm, warm South Bay welcome?
Thank you so much. Well, howdy. I wish more of that were true. And every now and then your pastor lies to you a little bit, so you have to forgive him. But I am grateful to have at least a small part in helping this congregation kind of grow and move forward. And for that, I'm very, very grateful. And I love this congregation. It's been a joy watching the church to continue to grow and face challenges. And so it's just been really, really great. One of the questions, though, that I have to ask is, why? Why has God blessed this church so very much? And in one sense, I think it's just because of the simplicity and clarity of your mission statement. You see it when you walk in, it's printed on your literature and so on, just helping people find and follow Jesus Christ. It's as clear as that. Pastor Gary's been so faithful to keep you on track to helping people find and follow Jesus Christ. Your staff, your elders have stayed focused on that. And so it's so terrific to see that. And I want to just talk with you a little bit about that, just maybe getting behind your own mission statement at a very, very personal level. And I know even when I say the word mission statement, for some of you, it's a painful thing because, you know, in your workplace or whatever, three or four of the big shots, they went away on a retreat. And when they came back, they had a word from Sinai and they had a whole new mission statement. And you had some terrible coffee mug that was printed on that you had to live with for 3 years until the next group went up to Mount Sinai and got their special message. And I know that, but I just want to say to you, wait a minute, the word mission, that's a Bible word. That's our word. The business community stole our stuff, okay? So we need to steal it back. And it's right to be on mission. It's right to stay focused in terms of mission. And so what I'd like to do, if it's okay, is just remind you of the Apostle Paul's mission statement. It's easy, just six words. You can memorize it in a second. He says, Philippians 1:21, to me, to live is Christ. Now, that's about as boiled down as you can get it. But every component of that is significant. And if I can, I'd just like to take it apart with you for a second. So just start with that, to me. It has to be personal. That's the beginning of really living out a mission statement. It has to be deeply, deeply personal. Not intellectual, not, I believe, but I'm so busy I can't live the Christian life. I'll get to it later. No, that's not believing at all, you see? Not political. I believe, and you can see it in how I vote, every 2 years. The rest of the time I contradict my faith. But those 2 years, boy, every 2 years, I'm really faithful. No, that's not a personal connection with God. Not private, even. The Christian faith must be deeply personal, but it is not individual. When you come to faith in Christ, God gives you this gorgeous community of people that you get to walk together with. And they are a key to you moving forward in your faith. And we saw that in COVID, didn't we? Under COVID, for various reasons, many of us got isolated from the church. And did you feel it? As you got separated from the church, you felt your faith waning in certain areas. We need one another. So the Christian faith is deeply personal, but it is not a private faith by any means. And so for it to be deeply personal, it has to be centering, first of all, on Christ. That's why the Apostle Paul says in this letter later on, he says, you know what my goal is? To know him, to know Christ. And the power of his resurrection. Wow, that's fantastic. And then listen, and the fellowship of his sufferings. See, he wanted to know Christ in every possible way. And it was profoundly personal for him. Maybe not just a mission statement, but a creed, if you want to say it that way. You know, that's from that Latin word, credo, I believe. And when you deeply believe it, it changes how you live. You may remember Martin Luther King Jr. in his I Have a Dream speech. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. There's the word. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. And what he was saying is, listen, you don't believe it if you're not helping make it happen. See, that becomes the question. Is it personal for you? You say, well, where does it begin? Well, it begins in your mission statement. You know, you want to help people find and follow Jesus Christ. You begin by finding Christ. You can know about Christ. You have to enter into a full and final trust with him and him alone. You say, well, no, I found Christ. Well, great. Are you following? Are you continually following him? You say, well, I used to follow a lot. Hey, come on. Get with it. You see? He says, no, I'm finding, I'm following. Great. Are you helping? Because God has positioned you in prudent places so that you can help somebody move forward in their faith. To me, to live is Christ. To me, to live, it's not just practical, personal, it's practical. You got to hear that. And I love it for the Apostle Paul, because when he wrote this little sentence, he wrote it in prison. And he's like, I may be in prison, but let me tell you, I'm really living. Because your circumstance cannot define who you are. Christ defines who you are. As a matter of fact, this little book of Philippians becomes known as the book of joy. Because Paul says, hey, nothing's going to steal my joy away. I'm walking with Christ. And so the question is, do I let my circumstance drive me off task? Or do I really center in who Jesus is? Paul says this. And later on, he says, I've learned to live with almost nothing. And I know what it is to have nearly everything. Then listen. I've learned the secret of being content. There's a word we don't even hear anymore. Find someone who's content. I've learned the secret of being content. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. See, when it's centered on Jesus, everything goes away. And I know that it becomes a challenge, because people think, yeah, but I'm facing some circumstances that are tough. I get that. You may have circumstances in your life that you wish God didn't know about. But you see, the beauty of it is Christ would walk with you in that. Christ would walk with you through your addiction. You're like, I'm ashamed of my addiction. That's okay. Like, I don't want anyone to know about my addiction. Can I tell you something? Jesus knows. No one even gave him a hint. He already knows. And he walked with you through your addiction. Is it a sexual addiction? If it's a chemical addiction? If it's a love affair with the refrigerator? Whatever it is. He's not afraid. He will walk with you through that. Why? Because the Bible says Jesus is our merciful and faithful high priest. And he's able to sympathize with us in all of our weaknesses. He knows what it is to live in this challenging world. Jesus would walk with you in your depression. You say, well, I mean, what does Jesus know about depression? Listen, on the night in which he was betrayed, he said, now my soul is deeply depressed, even to the point of death. You're like, no, my Bible doesn't say depressed. That's true. You don't sell Bibles if you say that Jesus was depressed. But that's exactly what he's saying. It was a depressing moment. And though Jesus was utterly God, he was entirely man. And he felt the weight of that depression. He'll walk with you through that. He knows specifically what's that like. You may have a struggle with isolation and the feeling that you're alone and that no one gets it. Listen, can I tell you someone who knows what it is to have everybody in his life check out on him? The Lord Jesus Christ. Even the people who said, don't worry, I'm there to the last. They left the first. And yet still, he was faithful to them. He'd be faithful to you. He understands what you walk with. All he asked you to do this, listen, follow. Helping people find and follow Jesus Christ. Jesus' signature command, follow me. That's it. And the challenge is sometimes we followed him, but we stopped following. And we're stuck in a place. The invitation of Christ is, come on, get up, just keep on following. To me, to live is Christ. Ah, it is possible. Personal, practical, it's really possible. It's a beautiful thing. It's possible to live the life that God intended for you. But I have to tell you the truth. First, we have to get rid of the idols and images in our life. And I know you think, well, look, this is not like the ancient world where they had idols of, you know, wood and stone. Oh, you're right. We do it with cardboard. We don't even waste time on building a fancy one. We hold up this cardboard image. You hear it? We hold up this cardboard image of ourselves. And we ask people to believe, this is really who I am. And we point from behind the cardboard and say, please, please believe this. I know who I am, but I don't want you to know. Please accept me. Please like me. Please say I'm okay. Please believe I'm successful. Then, you know, the problem is while I'm holding the cardboard this way, you guys are sneaking a peek. It's like, no, I want you to believe I'm successful too. And it's a frantic waste of time. You end up being like that guy in Wizard of Oz. Do not look at the man behind the curtain. It's just a terrible place to be. I'm going to say this. No one knows you like Jesus knows you. And yet no one loves you like Jesus loves you. And if you get that truth, you find for the first time it's possible to be yourself. And beyond that, it's possible to become all that God wants you to be. You don't have to hide who you are because Jesus knows about it. You don't have to fear who he wants you to become because Jesus will walk you with you in that direction. And it's just living an entirely different life, but it's all about the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I know for some of you, you say, wait a minute, that's not the whole sentence. To me, to live is Christ. There are four key words that you left out. You're right. To die is gain. Right? That's the rest of that sentence. That's the perpetual component. That's the thing that gives us something beyond the grave, something that will endure for eternity. And it's a terrific thing. I travel a lot. And, wow, when you travel a lot, you end up filling out lots of forms. You enter all these different countries, and man, they've got all the forms and your passport number and the expiration date and so on. But here's where it gets down to it. It's like birth date, and then you got to figure out, is it month? Day, year, month, date. They just, everyone does it different. But here's the form, the thing I've never seen on the form. Birth date, right underneath it, anticipated death date. That would sober you up in a hurry, wouldn't it? Right? What's your birth date? When do you plan on dying? Just jot that down next. See, what that would do, it would reveal to us something about the mission statement we've been living that we weren't even aware of and how foolish it would be. If we had to put a t-shirt on that said, this is really my mission right now. To me, to live is to live comfortably. To me, to live is to retire early. To me, to live is to hit a golf ball farther than anybody I know. To me, to live is to pursue recreation. To me, to live is to be perceived as a success, even though I know who I really am. Do you see how shallow it rings? How hard it is to just to hear that stuff? I want you to believe that, you know, I look good and whatever it is. To me, to live is to get my degree. Okay. Like I say, I travel a lot. And I end up on the plane for long times. And, you know, you sit down with somebody, you're not only going to be with them for the 12-hour flight, but sometimes you're there for the 2-hour hold. And sometimes you're there for the 2 hours that you're waiting to get off the runway. So you get to chat. And you may not get this, but one of the most frightening questions that you can hear if you're a pastor on an aircraft sitting next to someone you do not know is, so what do you do? Because you know if you tell them, they're going to be apologizing for all the vocabulary they've used in the last half hour. So I always say, well, I'll tell you what I do. We'll get to that. But I'd like to know first more about you. What do you do? Well, I just got my degree. I graduated. I'm a software engineer. So, oh, really? Where are you going to go with that? Well, I worked as an intern in a company, and it seems like they want to hire me. That would really make me happy. I love that company. So, wow, that's great. Then what do you see happening? Well, it's not that big of a company, and I honestly think that I could have influence, and I would hope to actually rise in leadership on that company. Wow, that's cool. Then what do you see happening? Well, I've always had this dream of starting my own business. That'd be cool. If you could do that, then what do you see next for you? Well, it sounds a little arrogant, but I think I have a book in me, because I see software differently than other people, and I'd like to write about that. That'd be cool. Well, then what would you do with that? Well, I mean, if the book really worked, I think I could speak, just travel and speak behind that. Wow. Well, then what would you do? Well, I mean, by that time, I'd probably be ready to retire. Oh, really? Then what would you do? I say I like to fish, but I really never have time for fishing, so I probably do quite a bit of fishing. Well, I love that. I love to fish myself. That's great. Then what would you do? Well, I guess I'd die. Well, then what would you do? And it's an interesting thing to sit with someone who doesn't know you. You're a complete stranger to them and hear them say, that thought terrifies me. To hear them say, I actually have no idea. To hear them say, I'm just hoping, and I don't even know if it's right, but I'm just hoping. See, that's when I say, well, let me tell you what my job is. My job is to help you answer with absolute confidence what your plan will be at that moment in just the same way that you've anticipated all your life plan. Because I break it to them. You know, you already sense it. You're not just a person who has an earthly existence. You feel it. You have an eternal existence. And if you don't have a plan for eternity, you don't have a solid plan for now. See, that's the challenge, isn't it? Go to the graveyard and you'll see it. Here's the birth date. There's a little dash. Here's the death date. There it is. Birth date, death date, dash in between. Don't you know most people are living their life for the dash? That's it. The truth of it is, there's a line that extends on into eternity. You start living your life for the line, and you'll be fearless with anyone who lives their life for the dash. You'll be free from anyone who's controlled by the dash. You will be able to function in an entirely different way. It's an enormous gift. It's a terrific opportunity. And if you are a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, you can help make that impact in your world. And it's such a blessing. You say, okay, where do I start? You start with your own mission statement. You find Christ. And then you determine to follow him. And then you say, okay, Lord, I want to be a helper. I want to help people towards you. And I want to take a minute and give you a chance to pray about exactly that. And I want to say this even before we pray. While we're praying, the kids are going to come walk up on stage. And they know how to walk. They practice. They rehearse this. So let's not miss this chance to talk deeply with God. Okay? Let's pray. Just you and God right there. This is your moment to be ready to respond to him. And if you're at the front end, the beginning is to find Christ. You cannot give away what you have not received. This is your moment to say, Lord Jesus Christ, I'm ready to respond to you. If you've never put your full and final trust in the Lord Jesus, now's the moment to do that. And you don't have to say any special or fancy words. I came to Christ in the middle of the night in my own bedroom, but Christ came to me fully. But if you're ready to say, Jesus, I give up trust in myself. It hasn't worked. And I put full and final trust in you, in who you are, and what you've done for me. I accept that you are entirely God and yet utterly man, that you lived a life that I could never live. You died a death that you didn't have to die. And so I put my trust in you that death was for me, that you died for my sins. You say it, you mean it. Trust me, he knows how to work with you. He'll receive you. Maybe your challenge is following. You followed for some period, but somewhere along the line you stopped following. You got diverted, you got misdirected. Today's the day to say, Lord, I want to follow again and fresh. Maybe this is the day for you to say, Lord, I need to renew a daily time with you. Maybe this moment is the time for you to say, Lord, I want to reconnect with the body of Christ in a deep way. And I'm not going to quit until I am with others who are walking with you. Maybe you're just at that place. It's time for you to help. God's a very strategic God. And he's placed family, neighbors, friends, co-workers in your life. Some of them even popping in your mind right now. And now's the time to lift them up and say, Lord, would you help me know when and where to say a word for you? Now's the time. Lord, we just want to thank you and bless you for your mercy to this church for many years. And I pray for this congregation that you'll help them to be as faithful to you as their leadership has been for a long, long time. Please use them, bless them, multiply them. Ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
The splinter of the king, clothed in majesty, but all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice, 'cause he wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great, is our God. How great is our God. How great is our God. Sing with me, sing with me. How great is our God. Sing with me. How great is our God. And oh, we'll see how great, how great is our God.
To see all generations worshiping together. It reminds me of Psalm 145. It says, one generation will declare your mighty works to another. Well, as we close, if you're able, let's all stand. Let's continue to sing of the goodness of God together.
been so good. He's been faithful all of our lives. Praise the Lord for that. Hey, I just, as we close our time together, I wanted to introduce a special guest who is here with us today, and that's Mayor George Chen, the newly elected mayor of the city of Torrance. And he just wanted to come up here and say a few words. You know, George has become a really good friend. And you know what I love about him is that he's a brother in Christ. He goes to a local church here, and we're just so thankful that God has put him in this position. But I'm going to kind of just turn it over to you.
Thank you, Pastor Gary. You know, just now you're singing the song, "All My Life You Have Been Faithful." I think I'm always in tears just being here with all of you, because it's your faithfulness to God and God's faithfulness to allow this church to grow, to touch the community all over. And here I have a certificate from the City of Torrance, which I will read. City of Torrance, certificate of recognition awarded to South Bay Community Church in recognition of your 30th anniversary of faithful service to the entire South Bay community. Your selfless love, service, and ministry have positively changed lives, not just locally, but globally. May God continue to bless your ministry.
Thank you so much. As you know, I was in politics before I went in the ministry, and I've seen a lot of these. I've worked with mayors, I work with members of the city council, but I've never seen one where the mayor would actually write, "May God continue to bless your ministry." Isn't that pretty great? So thankful that God has placed George Chen in this position. And I just want to remind you to keep him in your prayers as he leads our city to better and better things, okay? So I don't know about you, but I am so filled up just spiritually and emotionally from Pastor Matt's message and worship and everything else. I just feel so full, and I hope you are too. But now that you are filled spiritually, your tank is filled, we want to fill your tummies up. So right now we're going to dismiss you, and if you have children, you can go through this door. You need to get to the nursery or the preschool area, go get your kids. But what we want, if you're able to stay for lunch, we ask you to make your way out through these doors and then wrap around, and it'll take you right to our two Habit hamburger trucks. And for those of you who are vegetarians, we have a grilled cheese sandwich that they will make for you. Although I can't imagine anyone would want to eat grilled cheese when you can have a hamburger, a juicy hamburger, and some French fries. So go ahead and do that. I'll dismiss you in just a second. And then I want to remind you, come back next week. Next week we'll be back to regular service times, 5 on Saturday, 9 and 11. My voice is going on Sunday morning, and we're going to kick off a new series here, so don't miss it. Come back for that as well, okay? So let me pray for the food and our time, and continue to stick around and enjoy the rest of the afternoon with us. Father, thank you so much. What a great celebration this has been. And yes, Lord, today we celebrate your faithfulness, your goodness to us all these years. Tomorrow we get back to work, because there are so many people who are still living in darkness, and they need to see the light. And I pray that you would help us to be the light. Thank you, Lord, for Mayor George Chen. We pray that your favor would continue to shine upon him. You bless his leadership, God, as he leads our city to better and better things. And Father, thank you for the food that we're about to eat. Thank you for the fellowship. God, bless our time together. We love you so much. And when we leave this place, ask you to bless us as we go, and keep us safe until we meet again. And all God's people said, amen. Amen.